Yo, good morning. Welcome to the gathering. Would you stand with us as you're able? Go hug somebody. Tell me love as we start to worship this morning.
More than
than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord, more than the air I breathe, more than the song I sing, more than the next heartbeat, more than anything. And Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never wanna go back to my old life. I need you more than yesterday. I need you more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. Song I sing, more than the next heartbeat, and more than anything. And Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never wanna go back to my old life. I need you than yesterday. I need you more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. I need you more than yesterday. I need you more, and more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord.
Grab a seat this morning.
Friends, how many of y'all could say this morning that you're in need of God's love in your life? Amen. I think we all could say that. And what a joy it is to be in God's house in the gathering this Sunday. We appreciate you being here. I will introduce some people in just a few minutes that will be guiding us in worship. But as we come to a time of praying for certain requests and joys and concerns, what concerns would you like to bring before us this morning, Nathan? Jay and Heather Hackard, who lost their son this week, will be praying for them. Jay and Heather. Other concerns? Joy Locke, and who passed away. She has three kids still here, so we'll be praying for them. Other concerns? Lonzo Lamb, who died this morning. Definitely be praying for him. Other concerns? Richard and Joyce Lehman, who are members of our congregation, have COVID. So if you would remember Richard and Joyce.
Please be in prayer for my brother-in-law, Julian Jaramillo. He was in a motorcycle accident, and he's very fortunate to be alive and banged up really bad. So please pray for
JJ.
JJ.
JJ is who we've been praying for this week. Josh's brother-in-law who was in a motorcycle accident. So we're praying for JJ. Other concerns? But still in a lot of pain. So, yeah. Okay. We'll continue to pray for you and for David, Ellen. Yeah. Tom is... We prayed last week for Dominion Healthcare, who had 10 or 11, 13 outbreaks of COVID. And her brother, Tom, was one of those. So, are there other concerns? Reagan's cousin who went in for a procedure but had a stroke, and they're trying to decide on what to do next with this cousin. Other concerns? Friends, we need some joy this morning. Y'all have any joys at that? No! Mike, happy birthday, man. Should we sing to you or? we'll keep ourselves composed. But happy birthday, Mike. So you're having a birthday party soon. Today, be praying for the family, man. It'll be fun, Todd. Abby, you're 11. That's great. She will be in youth soon. She'll be there pretty soon. She's almost there. Other joys that we can mention. That could be a concern. I don't know, man. That could be a concern. We've got the confirmation retreat coming up on Friday, and we will be taking 8 confirmands plus a couple of extra adults. We always need extra adults. So if anybody wants to go and get no sleep and have a lot of fun at Camp Lookout, come see me. We'll sign you right up. Mark and I are taking the group, looking forward to it. That leads into next Sunday, which is a huge praise. Confirmation Sunday, we have 8 that we will confirm. What time will we be doing worship next week? 10 o'clock. Will it be in here? Where's it at? Down in the sanctuary. We've been on this training process. So 10 o'clock, if you come at 11, the only person here will be Josh in the backgrounds playing guitar. The ghost of Josh playing the guitar. That's right, man. The ghost of Josh, because he'll be downstairs. But if you come at 11, you'll miss out on it.
On Wednesday night, the youth did a fundraiser, and this church is very generous. We raised
$673. Woohoo! That's a lot of pancakes, guys. That's a lot of pancakes. And they were excellent. Mark's recipe. Homemade from scratch from Mark's dad. The famous Reedy family pancake mix. It was good stuff. Good stuff. I had chocolate chip in mine because they were extra special. Extra. Friends, today we have a couple of people here that I want to make note of. Our district superintendent, Hugh Kilgore, is here. Hugh leads our district, which includes about 67 churches. You said something like it, 63, 67. And he's basically my boss when it comes to that. So he is tasked with keeping me in line. So that's a full-time job, Hugh. I know it is. But we're glad to have Hugh here with us. And with Hugh, I want to present to you Bishop Deborah Wallace Paget. She will be your preacher. Bishop Paget is not only our, Bishop Wallace Paget is not only our bishop, but the Bishop of North Alabama. So she lives in Birmingham part of the time, and she lives in Alcoa the rest of the time. She splits her time between these two annual conferences. She's been a small church pastor, a large church pastor, a district superintendent, and has a lot of degrees, has been to school for a long time. And we are privileged this morning to be able to hear from her. And so I know it'll be a joy to hear her preach this morning. Are there other joys that you would like to lift before each other this morning? Hazmat training. That's great, man. With the rescue squad. Very nice. That's great. That's a praise for sure. Any other joys? Are y'all ready to pray? Y'all ready to hit it? All right, let's go to God in prayer. Oh God, what joy it is to be able to come to you in prayer, to be able to come honestly and openly and be able to center ourselves on listening and to learning from you. I pray that as we go throughout this season of Lent, that you would guide us, that you would allow us to use this season to grow in our relationship with you. God, we lift up the concerns for those that are hurting due to loss. We lift up those who are sick. And God, we lift up those that are just in need of a reminder of your love. May you greet them. May you meet them where they are and surround them with your love. God, we lift up our joys, the things in life that give us meaning in life. And I pray that you would guide us as a church to continue the mission and ministry that we do. Draw us close to yourself, we pray in the name of Christ. Amen. Friends, I have a video that I would like for you to see. This is the season of Lent. And so this is a prayer that guides us during this season. So would you pay attention to this, please?
Rain down on me, Almighty God. Shower me with your grace. Flood me with your mercy. For I am a dry and barren land, consumed by the rot of my sin, burdened beneath the weight of my transgressions. Pour out your loving kindness. Drench my heart with your presence. Renew my soul. Refresh my purpose. Reignite my passion. Rain down on me as I own my iniquities. Rain down on me as I humbly confess. Rain down on me as I enter your presence. Rain down on me, Almighty God.
Friends, we continue our worship by the giving of our tithes and our offerings. You are invited to bring your offering to the front, and you are also invited to light a candle in honor or in memory of a prayer that you have. But may we continue to worship this morning by our prayers.
Good morning, everyone. I would like to invite anybody, like Melissa says, who's young at heart, up here to come join Abby and I for a little children's moment. Oh man, we got a crew up here this morning. Good morning, everyone. Have y'all had a good week? How has Lent gone for y'all? I remember my group, we made a list of what we were giving up for Lent. Y'all sticking to them? Y'all doing good? Mm-hmm. Okay, so I have a question for y'all. I'm gonna cover it up so you can't read it. But anybody have any guess as to what this book is? Anyone? Somebody say it. She just said it. Cindy just said it. It's a cookbook. Y'all got it right. Good. Okay, so let's read. I stole this from the kitchen downstairs. I'll put it back after. So we got some chess pie recipes. Let's see what else. Lots of pie recipes. Anybody like peanut butter pie in here? Okay. So, except Jalen, sorry girl, she's allergic to peanuts. So this, anybody ever used a cookbook before? Very rarely, some of us just guess. Abby's used it. Okay, so if you've never used it, these are put together for a reason to help us not burn our desserts. So there are just lots of, if you all want to pass this around, there's lots of different ingredients, times you're supposed to cook. It gives us lots of directions on how we're supposed to make all of these delicious food, right? Now, Abby, can you hold up this book? Anybody tell me what this book is? A Bible. How do you think these two are similar? Anybody have any guesses? Anybody down there?
We both use them at Keith.
We do use both of them at Keith. We have some good cooks here at Keith. But the Bible gives us a list of instructions and things to do, things we need in our life, just like a cookbook does. It might not always be physical and as delicious as one of these lemon pie recipes in our cookbook, but this Bible gives us tips and tricks on how to pray, how to live like Jesus, and everything else that we need to be a good Christian. So, as we go out through this week, I challenge you all to look at your Bible and see how God might be instructing you to do things, okay? So, let me pray for us real quick, and we'll get back to it, okay? Dear God, I'm so thankful for today, thankful for all these people here today. Thank you for allowing us to be able to read and learn from your book and just have the opportunity to share it with others. Lord, we love you so much, and we pray for a good week this week. Amen.
Savior, I come and quiet my soul. Remember, redemption's healed where your blood was spilled for my ransom. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as loss. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down and rid me of myself. I belong to you. Oh, lead me and lead me to the cross.
And thank you to the worship leadership for the music. That was great, Josh and team. It is a joy to be here at Keith Memorial United Methodist Church today. I am honored to have the opportunity to come and to share with you. I am so pleased that the invitation was extended to me by your pastor, Reverend Melissa Smith. And isn't she doing wonderful ministry here at Keith Memorial? I am grateful for Melissa. I'm grateful for your district superintendent, Reverend Hugh Kilgore. Yes. Hugh is outstanding. And you have excellent staff. We also have here in this church our district lay leader, Rick Lay, and Rick is super. And I am grateful for you because this community is a better place thanks to this church. You are making a difference, not only within the walls of the church, but also outside the walls, and not only in Athens, Tennessee, and the Houston Conference, but all across the world as the Keith Memorial United Methodist Church. So know that my heart is filled with gratitude for who you are and for the witness you are in the world. I'm going to read two scripture passages. These are familiar passages. The first one is from Matthew's Gospel, and the second one is from Luke's Gospel. And they are accounts of how Jesus taught his disciples to pray. So the first one is from Matthew 6, verses 9 through 13. Pray then in this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. And then the other passage is from Luke's Gospel, chapter 11, verses 2 to 4. He, and this is referencing Jesus, said to them, "When you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us, and do not bring us to the time of trial." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So today I'm going to talk about a subject that is relevant to each one of us. I'm so excited about your 8 confirmands. Hugh and I had the opportunity, along with Melissa, to sit in. Denise is leading that class, and there were 7 of the 8 there, plus a couple of the mentors. And what a great group of young people. What I'm talking about today certainly relates to them as they are at the beginning stages of their lives as Christ followers. It's just as relevant, though, to the oldest person in this church. And it's something that is so important that our annual conference has made it the theme for this year. We launched the theme at the Lake Junaluska Annual Conference in 2022, and it will continue through June of 2023. I'm talking about praying together. Prayer together. Now, there's a great protocol for prayer, and you heard the 2 accounts, one from Matthew's Gospel and one from Luke's Gospel just a moment ago. The Lord's Prayer was put together and placed in a worship book over 200 years ago. It is a combination of these 2 accounts, and it's something that you hear prayed, and perhaps you pray on a regular basis. This protocol is very rich, and it can help us as we frame how we pray. And I want you to note, in that prayer, the pronouns are plural. Our Father, who art in heaven, give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. So even when we're praying individually, and certainly in a group like this, there's a sense in which we're connecting not only with God, but with other people. A number of years ago, a dear friend of mine who is now deceased, Jim Kemp, offered to me a model for prayer in the form of an acronym. And the acronym is simply P-R-A-Y, pray. I have found this to be useful in my own prayer life. P is for praise. And again, notice how the Lord's Prayer begins, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." Now, I want you to know that I was well into my adult years before I began to take seriously the importance of praising God as a part of my regular prayer life. I praised God through song, and I was grateful for God, but usually I went straight to the asking part. In recent years, though, I've been intentional about starting my prayer time by praising God for who God is and for God's amazing attributes. One of the ways I do that is by working through the alphabet with God's attributes. God, you are amazing. You're bold. You're courageous. You're delightful. You're everything. You're forgiving. You're gracious. You're holy. You're inspiring. You're just. You're kind. You're loving and merciful and never-ending. Omnipotent, powerful, quick, righteous, saving, triumphant, understanding, vivacious, wonderful, excellent, and you. Yes, God deserves our praise. And why do we praise God? Do we do it in order to affirm a divine ego who needs our affirmation? No, that's not why we praise God. We praise God to remind ourselves of who we are in relationship with God. When I praise God, I'm reminded that God is God and I am not. That God is the one who created the heavens and the earth and I am part of His creation. That God is a father and I am His daughter. So when we praise God, we remember who God is and who we are. Even as we're praising God, though, sometimes we find ourselves in a situation where we're out of sync somehow, spiritually. It feels like our relationship is a little off. Often that's because of sin in our lives, of things we've said or done or attitudes we have which don't align with God's plan and God's way. And so it is also good and right for us as a part of our regular prayer life, as a part of our daily prayer life, to repent. R is for repent. Now, repentance sounds like a very mysterious and deep theological word. And it is in some ways, but in other ways, it is simply asking God to forgive us for the sin in our lives and then turning and facing God's love and grace head on. Because you see, when we sin, we find ourselves sometimes like this, or even this in our relationship with God. I invite you to close your eyes for just a short time, not very long. I'll tell you when to open them, okay? And imagine yourself and imagine where you are right now in proximity with God. Are you looking God straight on? Or are you sideways because of some misstep in your life? Or is it possible that your back is even to God? Name anything in your life for which you need forgiveness. Maybe it's something that happened as recently as this morning, or maybe it's something that happened a long time ago and you just have a hard time letting it go. Picture the light of God, the strength of it, the power of it. And as you experience that light, turn back to face God. And now experience the joy and the transformation that comes from knowing God's love and grace. You can open your eyes now. You see, repentance is about turning and walking God's way. I love a statement by Winston Churchill. Perhaps you've heard this before. There is nothing wrong in change if it is in the right direction. To improve is to change. So to be perfect is to have changed often. Repentance means we change direction. Now, there's another dimension to repentance, though, that is really important. In the Lord's Prayer, we pray, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." You see, we've received so much grace and forgiveness from God through Jesus Christ, and we're called to show the same kind of grace and forgiveness to others. Not in order to earn God's grace, because God's grace is available to us without strings, but in response to God's grace. So P is for what? R is for what? And then we arrive at the aspect of prayer where many of us spend most of our time. What do you think that is? A is for ask. That's right. There's cheat notes there on the screen, right? The great theologian Karl Barth reminds us that there are six requests in the Lord's Prayer. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. Forgive us our trespasses. Give us this day our daily bread. Lead us not in temptation. Deliver us from evil. So you see, it's good and right for us to ask of God. That's part of the relationship. But it's important that we not only make request of God. Here's what I mean by that. And it's a caution for us. Perhaps you've been in a relationship where the other party received, and you gave and gave and gave. They were always asking different things of you, but they did not reciprocate. And after a while, you began to feel objectified. May we never objectify God. And if we find ourselves in a situation where we're only asking, when it's all about us, when it's we and me, and not you, God, then we risk objectifying God. And we find our prayer life out of balance. And then there's one more dimension to prayer that I lift up to you today. P is for praise. R is for. A is for. And Y is for yield. To yield simply means that we subject ourselves to God. In the Lord's Prayer, there's the line, "Thy will be done. Thy will be done." Jesus didn't only teach that concept, he lived it. And the greatest example of that in Scripture that I know of comes in the Gospel of Luke, where Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane right before his arrest. The next day, he would be crucified on the cross. He was aware that there were difficult hours ahead of him. And he prayed to God to remove the cup that was ahead of him. Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Now, who would have blamed Jesus if he had stopped right there? After all, he was doing great good in the world. He was teaching. He was preaching. People were experiencing salvation. Healings were occurring. Miracles were taking place. His disciples were not yet ready to receive the baton he was going to be passing to them. But Jesus did not stop there. Look at that last line, that last phrase. Yet not my will, but yours be done. That's what it means to yield. And you might say, okay, it was important for Jesus to yield. Because after all, he had a mission of saving the human race, of transforming the world. But why is it important that I yield to God's will? The answer to that question was driven home to me a number of years ago when Lisa, my daughter, Andrew, was a preschooler. Her little brother, Andrew, was a newborn. Leandra was so excited about having a sibling. At the same time, she was shocked to discover that now her parents were really spending a lot of time focusing on Andrew. And so she began to act out. I say that she was overly directive. My husband Lee says that she was bossy. And he's closer to right than me on that. She bossed her dolls, her Sunday school teachers, her little brother who had no idea what she was doing, even her mother and father. One day, she barked out yet another order to me. And I said, Leandra Wallace Paget, you and Andrew are the children. Daddy and I are the bosses. Do you understand? Well, she did not answer that question in the moment. A couple of days later, she gave me her response, though. Out of the blue, in the sweetest voice imaginable, she said, Mommy, I have a good idea. You be the boss, and I'll be God. It's been a long life. Leandra's now 31 years old, and she's a great person, I tell you. But that did give us an inkling of her personality. Though we are too sophisticated, typically, to articulate those kinds of words to God, sometimes our actions indicate that we want God's advice, we want God's assistance, we want God's input, but we want to drive our life. We want to be in charge. And yet, thy will be done. It's about us not only saying, but living the reality that God is God and we are not. God is the one in charge, and we are the ones who follow. And the opportunities to practice yielding really emerge in our lives on a regular basis. For instance, we may be so tired on a Friday, and then a colleague or a friend or a family member calls, and they need a caring, listening ear. And we yield to God by being that caring, listening ear. Or we may have a way that we want to spend some money that is purely for our own benefit. It's not a need. It's not even necessarily something that's important to have, but it's something that we want. And then there is a deep need of someone in the community that comes to our attention. And we give some of that money for that. Or you go on and on and on thinking of ways in which we have the opportunity to yield. I mentioned in the very beginning of this message that the theme for annual conference this year is pray together. And prayer is something that the confirmands will be really deepening as they continue in their faith journey. And it is something that each one of us can increase in intensity and in regularity in our own lives. And as we do, we will find ourselves praising God more and more, repenting for the sin in our lives, and also having forgiving hearts to those who hurt us, asking God whatever is on our hearts, and then posturing ourselves in such a way that we yield to God's direction and plan in our lives. And as we do so, we find that we experience change in our lives. In fact, what a life-changing, church-transforming action it is to pray together. Let's pray. God, it is the most incredible gift to have the opportunity to pray, to communicate with you, the God of the universe. Sometimes we take for granted that gift. Other times we lean into it. We pray that you will increase our regularity in prayer, and that we will also grow in balancing our prayer life, and that as a result, we will be changed more and more into your likeness, and this church will become more and more the church you've called it to be. These things we pray in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you stand with us as you're able?
Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus, you're the center. Every honor you at the center of it all. Center of my life, Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters. It's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. Jesus, be the center of your church. Jesus, be the center of your church. And every knee will bow, and every tongue shall confess you, Jesus. And Jesus, 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 nothing
Let's give Bishop Pageant a thank you for coming and being with us. Let me let you know of a couple of things this week going on in the life of our church. Our United Methodist men are meeting on Thursday morning at 8 o'clock for breakfast at Maddie May's. So keep that in mind if you are able to do that. Our confirmands are meeting this afternoon at 5 o'clock for a service project. And then Confirmation Sunday is at what time next week? 10 o'clock. See you at 10 o'clock next week, not 11. Go this day in peace and realize that God goes with you wherever you go.